Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how the show works. There's teachers from Dial Teacher standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
So if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
Now you can also send us your questions at our website, homeworkhotline.org, and just click on the Yak Back button and send in your questions. Okay, it's Tuesday, and that means it's time for our creature teaser.
Okay, now this creature can be found spending most of its time in the trees of the tropical forests of Central and South America. This animal is able to turn its feet backwards to run easily in either direction along branches or up and down the trunks. This creature also has a strong prehensile tail, which it uses as another arm when it travels from tree to tree.
Now, this creature may sound like it's related to primates, but it's actually related to raccoons. Now, it likes to use its long tongue to steal honey from bees' nests, and so it's sometimes called a honey bear because of that.
So it's not related to the bears either. Okay. So if you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904, or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
But every correct response we had at our Hotline Hall of Fame earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. Okay.
Now you knew that one. You know the answer.
And they actually are kind of related to bears.
They are. Yeah. Okay, all right. All right, so We've got some questions tonight. Let's do some homework. What do you think?
Okay.
Okay, hello?
Hello?
Hey, who's this?
Isaiah.
Okay, Isaiah, I'm going to go to the board to help you out with your homework, okay?
Mm-hmm.
What grade are you in?
Sixth
grade, okay. So, math problem, I hope?
I'm going to go to the board to help you with your homework,
okay? Okay, turn your TV down, Isaiah, okay?
Okay.
So that you can just listen to me on the phone, okay? All right, so what's your math problem?
Okay. Uh-huh. 36 divided by X equals 6.
So 36, whoop, we got some crazy stuff going on here. Let's try that. Hold on a second. Bink. Let's see. 36, wow. Divided by, now do you have a division sign or do you have like a fraction bar?
Division sign.
Okay, 36 divided by X equals 6.
Okay.
Okay, great. Any special way you've got to do this? You got to use algebra. What do you got to do to solve this problem?
Algebra.
You got to use algebra. Are you using a tape diagram at all?
Huh? Yeah, you got to use a tape diagram.
Oh, and you got to use a tape. That's an important thing, right? That's one of the tools that we're going to use, and we got to make sure that we use the right tools, okay? So okay. We have to use a tape diagram. So a tape diagram looks like what? We start out drawing something that looks kind of like a big piece of tape. That's why it's called a tape diagram. So I'm just going to draw a big, giant rectangle. And this rectangle stands for the whole. So if we're trying to find out 36 divided by what number is 6, what's the whole length of this tape diagram?
36 boxes.
36. Well, it doesn't necessarily need to be 36 boxes. It's 36 long, but it could be made up of 36 boxes. And some teachers write it on the top. Some teachers write it on the bottom. I have a little bit more room on the bottom. I'm going to write it like this. And that tells me that this whole piece of tape is 36 long, right?
All right.
Okay, now we want to know, if I broke this into sections, how many sections would there be if I had 6 in each piece of each section, okay? So I'm just going to start breaking this into sections, and we're going to keep track of what numbers we're up to, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, each section needs to have 6 in the section, okay?
Okay.
All right, so I'm going to switch color here. I'm going to break this into a section, and how many needed to be in each section? We said six, right? So yes. We want to know if we have 36, if we broke it into how many sections would there be? And there was six in each piece, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So the first one's got to have six in it, okay? So we got to keep a running tally in our head. You ready to do that?
Yeah.
Okay. So the first one's got six, and I broke into one section here, right? I'm going to break off another piece, and I'm going to put another six in there. So how much have we used up of that 36 so far? If we use six and six, we've now used up. We're using up six plus six more is how much have we used up? 6 plus 6 is?
12.
12, right? We've used up 12, right? So now we're going to break it into another chunk, and that chunk needs to have 6 in it. So we had 12, and now we're going to add 6 more. We're kind of skip counting by 6s, okay? So what's the next number going to be? So 12 plus 6 more?
Yeah.
What do you get?
12 plus 6 more.
So we got 12 plus 6 more, we get 18. So we're up to 18 here, okay? So let's even put a little thing. We have 6, we've used up 12, we used up 18, okay? I'm going to break it into another section. Am I up to 36 yet?
No,
right? We want to see how many sections we get. That's what we're trying to find out.
Okay.
So we're going to draw another line down, and we're going to use up another 6. It's kind of like we're spending the 6s as we go along. So if we had 18 and we had 6 more, what do you think we're going to be up to? And a way to maybe help you think about it, so far we used up four groups of six.
All right.
Six times four is?
2 plus 4 is 24.
24.
No, that's 6 times 4.
6, 4, you're right. So we've used up six groups of four, which is 24. Or you can just kind of skip count by sixes, and you're just going to add 6 to 18. So you're doing a great job, okay?
Mm-hmm.
We're almost there. We're getting closer and closer to 36, right? I'm going to draw another bar. Whoo, gonna spend another of those sixes, okay? What's
okay.
24 plus six more?
You said who?
24 plus six more.
Okay, 24 plus six more. 31.
We're gonna get to 30, great. Are we at 36 yet?
No.
Nope, okay, let's spend another six, okay? Spend another six.
Okay.
Okay, what's 30 plus six more?
42.
Nope, 30 plus 6 more. We're still at 30.
36.
Wow, and that was the target number that we were trying to get to. So let's take a look at the original equation. It seems kind of long the way that we do this, but it really helps us to build some understanding about what the equation means, okay? So let's go back and look at this equation. It says if you had 36, and there's our 36, if you divided it into, I don't know how many pieces you're dividing it into, but each piece needs to have six, how many pieces would you divide it into? So let's count how many we need. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we would have to divide it into six pieces in order for each section to have six, okay?
All right,
and don't forget your answer is x equals 6.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, Isaiah. That was a fun problem.
Hey. Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, we have Aaliyah on the line. Hello, Aaliyah. How are you today? Hello?
Hello?
Hi, how are you today?
Good.
Good. Now, what grade are you in?
I'm in fifth.
And I understand you have a math question for me, right?
Yes.
Okay. And where are you calling us from, Aaliyah? Where do you go to school?
Elizabeth, New Jersey.
All right. And what are you working on in fifth grade math in Elizabeth, New Jersey tonight?
Scientific notation.
Oh, great. All right. What's the question?
3 times 10 to the 3rd power.
Okay. And what do we need to do with it?
Multiply.
Multiply? Okay, so
yes.
We got to put it in standard form?
Yes.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about scientific notation. Why do we use scientific notation? What's the nice thing about it? It allows us to work with very large or very small numbers, okay? Later on, when you get into high school science, you'll work with, in chemistry, you'll work with Avogadro's number, you know, and that's going to be 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. You wouldn't want to have to write out all those numbers, would you? Okay? No. So it allows us to work with very large or very small numbers. So you said to multiply this out, and that's exactly what we've got to do. We've got to change this to standard form. Okay? And there's two ways to do this. All right? We see 10 to the third. What does that mean? It means 10 times 10 times 10, right?
Yes.
All right. What would 10 times 10 be?
20.
Not 10 plus 10, 10 times 10.
Oh, 100.
100. 100. And what's 100 times 10?
100 times 10 is?
1,000, right? Whenever we add, whenever we multiply something by 10, we say we kind of add a zero. But really what we're doing, and this is going to be more important later when you get to, right, when you get to decimals, is you're moving your decimal point one place to the right each time we multiply by 10, because we're in a base 10 number system, right? So what you just told me, 3 times 10 to the third is saying 3 times 10 to the, times 1,000, right?
Yes.
What, or excuse me, 3 times 1,000, what's 3 times 1,000 going to be?
3,000.
3,000. All right. Now let's look at another way to do this one. Okay? We had 3, and we understand the decimal point to be after the 3, right? And if we say times 10 to the third, that means we've got to move 3 places to the right. 1, 2, 3. And we got to go back and put our zeros in, and we still get 3,000 that way, okay? And that's going to be much easier later on when you're working with decimals, okay? Got another one to do? Let's do another one, make sure we got it.
Okay.
All right, what's the next one?
6 times 10 to the fifth power.
10 to the fifth, did you say?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Let's do it the way I just showed you first, okay? So I have a 6. How many times do I got to move my decimal to the right?
Once.
Well, it's 6 times 10 to the fifth, right?
Yes.
So that means I'd have to move it
five
times. All right, so let's look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now I got to go back and put those zeros in. Okay, you agree with that?
Yes.
All right, so let's write that again without all those lines underneath. That's 6 with 5 zeros after it. What would we say that number is? It's
600,000.
Very good. Okay, could we get it the same way? Well, we could, because what's 10 to the fifth? Well, that's 6 times 1 with 5 zeros after it, right?
Yes.
1, 2, 3, 4. Did I count the right number? Yep. Okay, and if we multiply this out, we still would have gotten 6,000, right?
Okay.
All right, so which way have you been doing this at school? Have you been just moving the decimal, or have you been converting it to a number and then multiplying?
I've been doing it 4 times 10 times 10 times 10.
Okay, that would work too. Let's go back. So let's do this. What would 3 times 10 be?
Huh? Oops.
What would I moved away from the one we're on. We'll go back to our original one. So what would 3 times 10 be?
33.
30. 30, right. All right. So that's that much. 30 times 10, right? What's 30 times 10?
30.
All right, times 10, so 0. All right, 1 times 0 is 0. 1 times 3 is 3. Gives us 300, right?
Yes.
We got to multiply that by 10, right?
Yes.
All right. And once again, we get 0.
300.
All right, 300 then times 10 would give us 3,000. 3,000.
3,000.
Yeah, we had 300, but then we multiply by 10, right? Okay, so that would work too. But I think the easiest way to do it, if you understand that way, is just moving the decimal. So when you have a positive exponent, you're going to move your decimal to the right. Later on, when you get the negative exponents, you'll learn about moving your decimal point to the left. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Tell you what, you've got more of those too. Why don't you do them, call over Dial Teacher, they'd be glad to check your answers for you, okay?
Okay.
All right. Nice talking to you. Thanks for calling.
I said, hey, hey. Here's a fun saying to help you remember the basic needs of the human body. Oh, can Venus flies make pretty webs? This actually helps you remember oxygen, carbohydrates, vitamins, fats, minerals, protein, water.
Okay, we'll get back to questions in just a minute, but tonight we have our friends from Seneca Park Zoo. We have Tim, and Tim, we've got a very original name here.
Yes, this is Spot the Spotted Turtle.
Spot.
That's right. And Spot is a really great animal. He's kind of a small little guy. He's one of the smallest types of turtles that is found in New York State.
Oh, okay.
Now, I know a lot of kids watching, we talk about endangered species or animals that are disappearing. They think about animals that are found all over the world. But one of the animals I like to talk about is actually this guy right here. Mm-hmm. He's not listed as threatened or endangered in New York State right now, but he is a species of special concern. So basically, their population has been going down. They are starting to disappear, and we're trying to pay attention to more what's going on.
Okay.
The large part of the reason why that they're disappearing is actually habitat loss. Now, just by taking a look at where I'm going to be putting him back in, he does spend a lot of time in water, and he'd be found in like bogs and swamps, areas like that. Mm-hmm. And those areas are used for development quite a bit. So we have to be very careful when we're thinking about building houses or building out areas into swampy areas, because we might be taking up his home.
Now, there's a big population near here, the Burgeon Swamp, right?
There's a small population, at least in Burgeon Swamp, and actually a couple other locations.
Okay.
Mendon Ponds, might be able to find some, and there's a couple other areas right in this area.
So he is a full-grown turtle right now?
He is fully grown.
That's as big as he gets.
That's as big as he's going to get.
And I see he's got those spots. Now, is that like a ladybug where they've got spots? And like, that used to be like, that's how old a ladybug is. Is there any truth
not
to
for,
that?
Not for him. If you really look at some of, of his scales, you might be able to see some growth rings, but it's really hard for this kind. Okay. Those spots actually give him great camouflage. As I just said, he lives a lot of his time in the water, in the swamp. And the dark color of his shell and his scales help him blend in with the dark kind of murky waters, but the yellow spots that are all on there are kind of look like some of the plants that might be found in the water or some of the sunlight kind of peeking right through. So it gives him really good camouflage.
Cool. So, now what would this guy eat?
He eats mostly worms, fish. He'll eat eggs and tadpoles, amphibian eggs. Mm-hmm. He'll also eat bits of plants here and there. He'll eat algae and some other plant matter.
Very cool. Can you take him out again? He's got like the yellow on the inside, which is really interesting there.
Yeah, so and all of this is the bright colored spots does help signify how healthy he is. Mm-hmm. If he wasn't very healthy, he wouldn't have some of this the bright colored spots that he that he's exhibiting right now.
Oh, wow.
Does he have a tail back there?
He does have a tail. You can see that right there.
Oh, very cool.
And even though he is a small turtle, as I said, he's one of the smallest that you can find in New York State, he can tuck himself completely in, head, tail, and legs.
Mm-hmm. Unless, interesting, you talk about New York State, let's talk about these guys in the winter right now.
Winter, well, of course, it's really cold out.
Right.
And he's actually hibernating. He's doing a true hibernation. They're burying themselves in the mud, trying to get down below the frost line. And that's where they're going to stay the whole winter long.
Mm-hmm. Very cool. All right. And, I had a turtle as a pet. I mean, a lot of kids do. Turtles make pretty good pets, but we talk about salmonella a little bit.
That's
maybe
right.
Probably good to talk about that.
Yeah, one of the first things I'm going to do after it, because I've been handling it, is I'm going to go wash my hands. Salmonella can be found on almost all reptiles, so we have to do our protection and make sure we wash our hands. So then turtles really aren't too bad of a pet. They can be kind of fun. They're interesting to watch. But just make sure that when you get a turtle, do your research first. Find out where it came from. Make sure that it wasn't pulled from nature.
Yeah.
And also, there is unfortunately a lot of people that go, oh, I love turtles, and then they get one and they go, oh, this is not for me. Before you get rid of them, make sure you get rid of them in the form of giving it to somebody else who's going to take good care of them. Unfortunately, a lot of turtles are being released into the wild or into nature, and that doesn't work
indigenous,
out.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very cool. Well, thanks again for bringing him on.
Thank you, Spot.
And I can't make fun of Spot because my turtle's name was Tommy, so I'm set for original.
Thank you very much.
All right, thanks, Tim.
Do you want to know more about turtles and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on the videos.
All right. You have a call for us.
Okay, right. I've got a live call. I'm going to go over to the board. Hi, who is this? Hello? Hi, we've got a live caller. Who is this? With the math problem. All right, so, okay, sure. So the problem is 9x divided by 36 equals 6. All right, so this problem looks kind of similar to what we've got before, and hopefully you can call back and we can talk to you and help you walk through this problem. But I'm going to get started while I'm waiting for you to call back. We have 9x divided by 36 equals 6. It looks kind of like Isaiah's problem, but a little bit different. And we're not going to use a tape diagram. We're going to use a little bit more algebra to solve this problem. We have, taking a look at this, the object of all algebra is that you would like to get the x alone. So I've got this 9x, and I see it's divided by 36. And I'm going to kind of just write it another way. I'm going to write it this way. A lot of kids don't realize that that fraction line is just an unfinished division problem. You can use that instead of division. Sometimes that makes it a little less scary. Sometimes it makes it more scary. That's up to you. I kind of encourage my students to start using these fraction lines instead of the division thing. So I look at this problem. I know some number, if I divide it by 36, is going to get me 6. So there's a couple of ways to do this. The first is I'm going to think about this 9x. And who's bothering that 9x there? I see that it's being divided by 36. So when we do algebra, we're kind of undoing a problem. It's like somebody created this puzzle, and we're going to do the opposite. We're going to do backwards everything that they did. So they divided this 9x by 36. So we're just, to undo it, we're just going to multiply it by 36, because dividing and multiplying are inverse operations. So I'm going to multiply this by 36. So here I see this 9x is being divided by 36. So now I'm just going to multiply it by 36. Okay? But you know, in algebra, you can't just go about adding numbers and subtracting numbers. If you do something to one side, you have to keep it balanced. So I'm going to multiply the other side by 36. So what this does for us, because right now it doesn't look any easier, is I see if I have 36 and you divide it by 36, this is the number 1. Okay, so they kind of eliminate each other and we get the number 1, which makes life a little bit easier. And all I have left on this side is 9x equals. And then I have to do 6 times 36. Well, that's not too bad. 36 times 6, I don't know it off the top of my head. 3 times 6 is 216. So this looks a lot easier than that does. So this means 9 times some number is 216. So remember I said we're going to undo everything that's going on. So I see this x is being multiplied by 9. So we're going to do the inverse of multiplying, which is to divide. So now I'm going to hit a division line. And remember, the fraction line means to divide. And if I divide the left side by 9, I got to do the same thing to the other side, because it's all about keeping things balanced. You're doing inverses and keeping things balanced. When I look at this, I have 9 divided by 9. And 9 divided by 9, 9 goes into 9 one time, so I have 1x. And the last part I have is 216 divided by 9. So I'm going to put the 9 on the outside, the 216 on the inside. 9 goes into 16 three times, which is 18. Goes in two times. And then we're going to do 21 minus 8 is 11 minus 6 is 36. So we have 9 into 36. And 9 goes into 36 four times. So that get 36. We have no remainder. So that just tells me that x equals 24. So if I did 9 times 24, I would get 216. All right. Thanks. Sorry we missed your call.
I said, hey, hey. When multiplying fractions, begin by multiplying the numerators of the fraction, and then multiplying the denominators of the fraction.
Okay, we have a winner on Creature Teaser. Jaylene, are you there?
Yeah.
How are you today?
I'm good.
Good. And who's our Creature Teaser today?
Yeah.
What's our answer?
Well, it's the... the answer is the Kinkajou.
Kinkajou.
The Kinkajou.
Oh, did you look that up?
No.
No? You knew that?
You knew
Very
that?
Very good. Very good.
No, because we're studying... I'm into animals right now.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, what grade are you in?
I'm in fifth grade.
Fifth grade. Where do you go to school?
Brooklyn.
Brooklyn? Well, very good. Very cool. I'm glad you knew that one.
Now, have you ever seen a kinkajou in person at the zoo?
No, but in photos, yeah.
Yeah? That's very cool. And you know, we talked about earlier that you said they're not related to bears. I said they kind of are.
Kind of are.
Yep, they fall under the group carnivores, so that's why they'd be somewhat related to the bears. There's, you know, the things you're used to, like wolves and dogs and cats, they're all in that group of carnivores, and so are the bears. So they are a little bit related, but very cool. They're not related to primates as closely.
So, even though they have that monkey-like
Prehens Hotel.
Oh, cool.
So very, very cool. Well, thanks for calling. You got credit for that, and congratulations. But don't forget, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial a Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
Now, tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our series called Move to Include.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.